Hello and welcome. I'm Phil Torres, here to talk about innovations that can change lives. We're going to explore the intersection of hardware and humanity, and we're doing it in a unique way. This is a show about science by scientists. Let's check out our team of hardcore nerds. Dr. Shinny Somara is a mechanical engineer. Tonight, life or death in the OR. One woman in desperate need of a lung transplant and the medical innovation designed to save her. Now, the real life drama. Will a donor lung arrive before it's too late? Marita Davison is a biologist specializing in ecology and evolution. Tonight, swimming with sharks and a shark robot that may one day help protect these fascinating creatures. And I'm Phil Torres, I'm an entomologist. I study spiders in the rainforests of Peru. That's our team, now let's do some science.
Hi guys, I'm Phil Torres. Welcome to a very special episode of TechKnow. We're about to go on a journey with unparalleled access to a revolutionary technology with an incredible human element. It's an amazing story, and we have Dr. Shinny Somara here to tell it.
This story, honestly, was one of the most incredible things I've ever done in my life. It's changed my perspective on the human body, because what I saw was really close access to machines replacing the human body, essentially. This is cutting edge technology when it comes to organ transplantation. Let's take a look. Breathing. It usually happens so naturally that most of us never ever think about it. That is, of course, until there's a problem. Currently, 1,600 people are on a waiting list in the United States, all desperately waiting for a lung transplant, which is why we're here, to follow a transplant team to understand how they rush into action whenever a donor organ becomes available, and to learn of a new technology which could be a game changer in the organ retrieval process.
St. Joseph's Hospital is one of a handful of medical centers in the US enrolled in a clinical trial to test an innovative technology called the Organ Care System, also known as the OCS. The device allows vital organs like the heart or lungs to stay warm and functioning outside of the human body. If approved by the FDA, it could change the way donor organs are transported. Dr. Michael Smith is the surgical director of lung transplantation at St. Joseph's.
Historically, what we've done is we've simply taken them out of the donor's body and put them into an ice chest.
But on ice, fragile donor organs like lungs have a limited window of 6 hours before they're unsuitable for transplant.
That period of time, there's no blood flow or oxygen getting to those lungs, and that's called ischemia.
So as soon as the lungs leave a donor's body, those lungs are deteriorating, aren't they?
Exactly, yeah. So the cells really don't like that. What this new device has done is taken it so that we can remove the lungs from the donor and put them on this device that perfuses the lungs through the blood vessels with blood. And it also has a ventilator circuit that actually pushes air into the lungs. The lungs are constantly oxygenating warm blood as they would in someone's body. It essentially diminishes that ischemic time to almost nothing.
Lungs have been maintained on the organ care system for over 10 hours, almost doubling the current time they can be kept on ice.
You can expand your region of where you're willing to take lungs from just the Southwest for us to the Northeast. Travel is a non-factor.
Catherine Varsh is a transplant coordinator at St. Joseph's. it's her responsibility to monitor lungs and the device every step of the way, from the donor hospital to the operating room at St. Joseph's.
This is the monitor, which we take on the runs with us. And this is the brains behind the whole machine. We're able to set how much blood flow we want to have to go to the lungs or how much volume we want the lungs to receive while they're on the machine. So when the lungs are in flight, somebody will actually sit with this on their lap and change settings as required.
On this device, you can actually monitor function. So you know when you transplant those lungs that they are good lungs.
A transplant surgical team at St. Joseph's is on call 24/7. When a donor match becomes available, they rush into action and retrieve the organs needed to save the life of one of their patients. Patients like 69-year-old Victoria Bloomfield.
Whoa. Look at how skinny I was. I like that one. Yeah, we were gorgeous.
Brian and Victoria have been married for 47 years. Together, they raised 3 children. They kept active lives up until 3 years ago, when Victoria was diagnosed with idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, a chronic and ultimately fatal lung disease.
My husband calls it resignation. To me, it was acceptance that I knew how I was going to die. And you can either give up and say, boy, this is it, or you can take the last few years, you think, and work with that and do the best you can. So that's what I've been doing, actually.
For the past few years, Victoria has been tackling things on her bucket list, including learning how to work with glass. But recently, her condition has deteriorated. She constantly needs supplemental oxygen. Victoria contacted St. Joseph's to see if she was eligible for a lung transplant.
As you can see, there's scarring in the lower parts of the lungs, especially along the periphery of the lungs. This is a pattern of scarring we call honeycombing, which is classic for pulmonary fibrosis.
Dr. Rajat Walia is the medical director of the transplant team, which determined Victoria was indeed a prime candidate for a lung transplant. How urgently does Victoria need a new pair of lungs?
Victoria probably needs lungs within the next couple of months before her condition will deteriorate to the point that she may get sicker or may have what we call an exacerbation, which is what we are really scared about, because the mortality with that complication is extremely high.
So psychologically, are you ready for this transplant?
I'm ready for it. I don't have any option. There is no option. I either get the transplant or I just deteriorate.
Victoria decided to enroll in the OCS study. The trial is randomized, meaning that if a donor match is found, a card will be picked to determine whether the lungs will be delivered on ice or on the new system. The goal? To compare post-surgery outcomes for patients who receive their lungs on the OCS system with those who don't.
Just left Victoria's house. Mentally, she's got a great attitude towards life. She's full of hope. You know, just want that phone to ring for her.
And there may be another reason to hope that Victoria receives the lungs on the OCS system. Early results from the study show the OCS significantly reduced the incidence of a serious post-surgery complication called primary graft dysfunction, or PGD.
People that have had severe episodes of PGD don't live as long after the transplant when you look sort of months and years down the line.
We do know that patients with pulmonary fibrosis are at higher risk for developing primary graft dysfunction.
So it would seem that Victoria's case would prefer the OCS system just because it's a much more fragile case.
Yes, but we don't have control over which patient's going to get randomized. So it could be either one. We will know when her time comes if she gets the device or not.
For now, it's a waiting game for Victoria and her family.
So you're completely positive about the procedure, and do you have any worries?
sometimes you get these thoughts and you think, oh my gosh, you know, it's, of course they go through your mind. They go through your mind in the night. In the morning, you're just good to go. So I hope they call me in the morning. That's my best time.
Shinny, we were introduced to Victoria, a very spirited woman who's currently on the donor list.
I found Victoria so inspiring. She's a great grandmother with so much vivacity for life, yet she was in this really critical condition where she desperately needed lungs. And at this stage, we had no idea which way it was going to go. It was literally life or death. But take a look what happens next.
Victoria Bloomfield desperately needs a lung transplant.
Yeah. She's probably got less than a year left to live.
But a new device could mean the difference between life and death for patients like her.
There's a donor shortage, and unfortunately, you see many people die on the waiting list.
Is this machine going to change that wait time?
That's what we hope, because it'll make more organs available for people waiting.
The technology keeps donor lungs warm and breathing outside the body. It has the potential to improve the function and availability of donor lungs. Victoria eagerly signed up for the so-called lungs in a box trial. But will she get them?
I want to be back living. I'm too early to put out to pasture.
Just got off a plane and jumped in a cab. It's 2:30 in the morning and we're heading towards St. Joseph's Hospital where Vicky is waiting for her double lung transplant.
And they are arriving on the OCS machine.
So for those 3 hours, I really kept busy because I didn't want to think about it. You know, you want to receive the call, and then on the other hand, you're a little scared to receive the call. So for the last, actually, week, every time the phone rang, I looked and I thought, oh, St. Joseph's.
Because I remember last time we spoke, we talked about excitement and fear.
Now it's a little apprehensive. Yeah. And, you know, I do realize it's a big operation.
The incision will come from underneath one armpit and go underneath the breast and across the sternum and then underneath the other breast and the other armpit. Some of these chest incisions can stay with you for quite some time. You will have some discomfort, especially early on. So that's why the epidural is there.
Thanks.
All right, we'll see you inside, okay?
Thank you.
All right.
He's really cute.
He's a lot of attention
now. No, you can't do
it. I can't.
After a final consultation with Dr. Smith, Victoria is wheeled into surgery.
So at this point, how are you feeling?
I'm feeling pretty good. I'm excited to get this lung transplant done for this patient who's been waiting. You know, on the donor side, it's usually pretty solemn, but on this end, it's usually pretty exciting.
While Victoria's surgeons prep for surgery, there's one more critical player yet to arrive.
We're waiting for the organs to come up in the organ care system, and it's quite nerve-wracking.
Are those the lungs?
Yeah, those are.
These are the lungs. You can actually hear them breathing. It sounds like they're breathing on their own, but it's all mechanical. And it's just so incredible to be standing next to them.
While team members prepare to remove the donor lungs from the organ care system, Victoria's surgeons extract one of her diseased lungs.
So, native lung. You see what we're saying? You can see this lung is just very small, fibrotic, and contracted, you know?
This is one of the lungs.
There's no mistaking Victoria's disease lungs with the healthy donor lungs.
So completely different to...
Yeah, completely different from... But these are deflated, those are inflated, so that counts for some of the difference, but it is very different. The way to think about this lung, it's more stiff. Like when a sponge dries up, it becomes more stiff and firm, and that's what this lung is more firm. Well, that lung is much softer.
They replaced Victoria's fibrotic lungs with the donor lungs, one at a time.
That's left.
And then the moment of truth.
Okay, here it comes.
All right.
There it is. That's the lung inflated.
Now the right lung is inflated as well.
Wow.
Both lungs are fully inflated, and Victoria takes her first breath with them.
You going up on both, or you just...
No, I just did that one now with the lung. Right lung's down.
How do you think it went overall?
I think it went great overall.
After 4 hours of surgery, Victoria is breathing on her own with a new pair of lungs.
It's going to change Vicky's life.
Oh, yeah. I mean, before there was no life. I mean, it was just whatever was left, which could have been just months.
So 47 years of marriage, and now probably many more years.
Yeah, well, we're sure hoping so.
Honestly, for me, that was the most humbling experience I've ever had, watching lungs being extracted from Vicky's body and being replaced. And, you know, the donor, the surgeons, the hospital, the OCS machine all came together at that perfect time. And now Vicky has a brand new chance at life. It was truly miraculous. It's cutting-edge technology, isn't it?
Very much so. If this device is as efficient and efficacious as we think it will be, then it can be a game-changer in lung transplantation.
So my question to you is, why aren't there enough lungs currently on the donor list?
The lungs that are on the donor list, 80% of them are not suitable for lung transplantation. Only 20% of them get used. The pool becomes very, very small. And what's incredible about this technology is that it will hopefully advance to a stage where you can actually recondition lungs. So you can take the donor lungs out of the donor body and actually kind of recondition them by blasting them with antibiotics to get them into a state where they're not rejected as donor lungs.
Just by watching that story, I'm completely moved. And I know that, Phil, you covered a similar technique within the heart transplant system.
You know, I think for me, when I saw a heart beating on a machine, kind of like those lungs breathing on a machine, I just couldn't believe that that is our reality that we have right now. I mean, it seems absolutely like science fiction. And the fact that they can potentially treat these things outside of our body and just, I mean, these organs seem like they're alive and they're going from one human to another.
Well, they're actually starting clinical trials late this year on a liver in a box. So, you know, they're starting to use this technology on all different kinds of organs.
It really affects us as humans in a remarkable way. Now, Marita, you went for a bit of a swim.
I did. I got to swim with researchers at Cal State University Shark Lab, swimming with leopard sharks. They are developing a submersible robot that is basically following sharks and measuring all sorts of environmental conditions. So let's take a look at it. This is Catalina Island, 27 miles off the coast of Los Angeles. A place known for its beauty, both above and below the ocean that surrounds it. Most of the fish that call these waters home go relatively unnoticed, but one species is nearly impossible to miss. Leopard sharks, hundreds of them. So, if you were the director of Cal State Long Beach's Shark Lab and you're trying to revolutionize the way sharks are studied, it's not a bad place to set up shop.
This is going to change how we study animals in the ocean.
Chris Lowe is the director of Cal State Long Beach's Shark Lab. and getting to know him and his work means getting your feet wet.
Obviously, here, a day at the office requires a different attire, and it also provides a different view of the world.
It takes only a few moments underwater to understand Chris Lowe's passion for the ocean and for the sharks he studies.
What is it about sharks that interests you from a scientific perspective?
They're a canary in the coal mine for oceans. They tell us how healthy our oceans are. The challenges are really hard to study.
Because as a diver, you jump in the water and you want the sharks to come to you, and sometimes they do, and most times they don't. So that's always been the tricky part. How do we find a way of studying them?
The answer, he believes, is this.
This is the robot that we've been talking about. And Chris Clark, you are the man behind this. Tell me about it.
So we've got this autonomous underwater vehicle, AUV, and you typically deploy it in the ocean to go collect data. Mm-hmm. In this project, we want to collect data about sharks. Once it dives down, it uses a couple other sensors, compass, and something called the Doppler velocity log.
What are the sensors and what are they doing?
They listen for a tag that we attach to the sharks. Uh-huh. And we basically put this thing in the water. It listens for the tags attached to the sharks, and it will actually autonomously drive around and follow the sharks as they move. What we've got here are some dummy plugs, and these will actually attach to what we call hydrophones. Hydrophones are actually listening for some acoustic tags that we will actually attach to a fish or shark, and every 2 seconds they'll just ping, ping.
So these robots have been used for about a decade now. Oceanographers have used them to go out and measure all different sorts of things in the ocean, water temperature and light and salinity and chlorophyll. And what we're doing is we're asking the robots to do one more thing. We want them to actually follow a shark and characterize the environment while they're following the shark so that we can build a 3D map around the animal that it's tracking. And it knows exactly where the animal is in that 3D space as it's moving. So our goal is to be able to say, when the animal suddenly does something different, is there some aspect of its environment that's causing it to do that?
Of course, all this is easier said than done, which is why the group comes to Catalina, testing.
So the experiment that we're doing now is we're hiding the transmitter on the seafloor. We're gonna then send the robot out to try to find it and get as accurate a position on it as possible.
The two Chrises know they've hit the mark when the robot locks in on the target and starts circling around. And guess what? It's circling now. How do you see this technology changing the way you do marine science?
I envision a day where we're going to have fleets of these robots, and they're going to enable us to measure aspects of behavior that we've never been able to measure before. And we're going to build a database of the ocean that's never been created at this scale. This is going to change our field.
If I learned anything today, it's that science and innovation can really come in a diversity of forms, from organs on machines to robots chasing sharks. Really incredible stuff today, guys, and we will see you here next week on TechKnow.
Dive deep into these stories and go behind the scenes at aljazeera.com/TechKnow. Follow our expert contributors on Twitter, Facebook, Google+, and more.